Welcome to our latest edition of Breaking Down Barriers, where we look at the different research and social stigmas surrounding Huntington's disease from across the world. I'm excited to be able to welcome three fantastic panelists who are also members of the HDYO community to share a little bit about their perspectives when it comes to different cultural barriers and stigmas, when it relates to different access to care, access to resources, and also access to support. So I'll call on them individually to introduce themselves, and then we'll get started with the conversation. So Ann Elizabeth, I'll start off with you.
So hi, my name is Ann Elizabeth. I am born and raised in Sweden, Swedish father, Colombian mother. And my dad had Huntington's disease. My uncle had Huntington's disease. So that's my connection. And I myself am at risk. However, currently I'm living in Colombia, studying here since 5 years ago. And so, yeah, I got like a dual perspective of how things are going when it comes to HD and stuff in those countries.
Thank you so much for being here, Anna Elizabeth. Mustafa.
Hi, everyone. I'm Mustafa. I grew up in Pakistan. My mother had Huntington's disease. Three of my aunts had Huntington's disease. A cousin also recently passed away from HD. Currently, I live in Toronto, pursuing a PhD, working on Huntington's disease research.
Yeah. Thanks so much for sharing, Mustafa, and for being here. And last but certainly not least, Megha.
Hi, everyone. My name's Megha. I'm from India. My father had Huntington's, my aunt had Huntington's, and my grandfather had Huntington's. I've tested gene positive a couple of years back, and I live in the UK, but I'm in India for a couple of months right now. And I think the same as Anne Elizabeth said, I've been fortunate to be able to get a different sense of Huntington's after living in the UK and just seeing the difference between that and the Indian landscape. So, yeah.
I think this is going to be a really unique conversation because not only are they representing a community where they grew up, but then also traveling to different countries and living in those different countries to kind of have one foot in each of those different countries with the access that they could receive and support within where they currently live. This is a really important conversation to continue. We started this with an April breaking down barriers. We looked at three communities and those different stigmas, but we need to continue to increase our awareness in order to do better as support services and to understand what some of those intrinsic interfamilial cultural barriers exist so we can help break those down to best support the community for whatever they need. And so I wanted to, again, ask our panelists, why was it important for you to be a part of this conversation? And I'll go in reverse order. So I'll start with Megha this time.
I think it's important because lots of people, at least my assumption of Huntington's was very skewed to how the Western world had it. I wasn't aware of what it was like in India. I didn't know of another family that had it in India when I found out about it. The first platform that I reached out to was HDYO on their Facebook group. And I feel like it's a disease that plays out in different ways in different countries, obviously because of the cultural stigmas. And I think it's important for people to see that representation and know that they can reach out to people and talk to them, and it doesn't feel like they're sat wherever they are, not being able to have people, you know, in the next city or have healthcare in a town next to them. So I feel like it's important that people realize that it's not just in the Western world, it is everywhere else. So, yeah.
Absolutely. Mustafa.
Yeah, similar experiences to Megha. We weren't told what HD was till like later. Nobody talks about it in the country I'm from. There's a huge stigma attached to it. People aren't really comfortable, you know, going into family histories or like talking about it as a disease and talking about maybe the more mental illness portions of it. Similarly to Megha, I also reached out to HDYO, which was my first interaction with someone who could actually talk to me properly about HD. Previously, when in my home country, when I used to talk to doctors, I wouldn't get straight answers because they wouldn't be too familiar with the disease either. So I think it's very important to talk about the overall stigma attached with just talking about HD in the first place and treating it as like an illness rather than something to be super, you know, afraid of.
Mm-hmm. And Elizabeth?
Since I was born into a family with HD, both the cases with my uncle and my dad in Sweden, they sadly just got diagnosed, got brochures, and that was it. My mom didn't have like a lot of information in Spanish. She only got a brochure, tiny brochure, what the disease implied, but they never like really explained it further to her to understand what's going on with her husband. And being an immigrant makes it harder because the doctors just treat you like you're stupid or something. So they didn't do much with my mom, which was very sad. And we actually had a moment where we brought my dad to Colombia because the heat here in Medellin actually helped him better than the cold in Sweden. So he lived here with my grandmother, and we tried to reach out to neurologists, HD association and everything, and nothing went well. Nothing was like structured or anything. So it was really sad, and it was like very stigmatized about HD in general because no one really understood what it was here. And sadly, in the rural areas, it's even worse because people usually think that it's caused by God being mad at you or a curse that someone put on you. So even if Colombia and Sweden are like two different countries, there's still today a kind of a stigma around that disease just because it has involuntary movements and it kind of is genetic and stuff. So people really do get scared when it's in the case of Mustafa, like it should be treated like anything else normally, like an illness or something, and not being something scary or that a person with Huntington's disease is a monster, because that's usually what people think they are when they walk on the street or are exposed. So, yeah.
Well, I think that leads... Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, just jumping in off of Anna Elizabeth's experiences, I also had similar experiences where my mother was treated as someone who was possessed. So there's definitely an aspect of the disease that to other people conveys something supernatural sometimes, especially in Pakistan. I don't know if there was, Omega had similar experiences.
Yeah, I remember meeting a family. Luckily, that wasn't the case with my family, but I remember meeting a family where they thought they were cursed, and their neighbors thought they were like that. If you, they had to be untouchable because if you touched them, you could get it. So they were really ostracized in their community. And I think it's a thing across the world, because I feel like most countries are God fearing, and it results from that, in my opinion.
Yeah. Similarly, I met a family. Yeah. Go ahead, Jenna.
I was just going to say, especially in rural communities or countries where there's a lack of education or awareness around what HD is, it's definitely a jump that we see that people do take, that there is some kind of higher power causing the disease or bad luck or what have you.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Like Megha mentioned, there's huge ostracization, I think, especially in rural communities. If a family has HD, they're ostracized from general community life because of the disease. And it makes it worse because people aren't aware of the disease, that it runs in the family or the genetic component of the disease. So they're kind of like blaming everything on supernatural things rather than trying to address the disease itself. Mm-hmm.
And that kind of leans to the next point, which is, which I'm curious about, is in your family, what was that conversation like about speaking about HD? And, you know, were you open about talking within your family? And even taking a step further, was your family open with talking about it with people outside your core family unit? It could be to extended family members or even friends or other community members.
I can go first. The short answer is no. Nobody was comfortable about talking about it at all. I think the way we were told was also pretty bad. So we were all, like, I have three sisters. All of us were told at the same time. And we were all different ages at that point. So my youngest sister had a completely different experience of being told to me when I was like 15. In terms of like talking to other family members, it's kept very hush hush, you know. So I talk to other family people now, and they still don't know what HD is, whereas they saw my mother go through it and pass away from it without ever knowing what the disease was. You know, so that's the current state of things.
In my family, it was completely the opposite of Mustafa, actually. There was no shame of admitting about the disease at all. My grandfather, who also had HD, my uncle and my dad were very open. They even told their coworkers and everything when they started having symptoms that that was the reality, because they are, well, they worked at Volvo, which is like a car, what is it called? Those cars, those who make cars, and the bigger ones that I don't remember the name in English.
The factories.
Yeah, but then, I mean, like those large cars that
transport. Oh, limousines.
Yeah. So all of them worked with that. And of course, with the involuntary movements and stuff, that would be like very tricky. So the good part about Sweden is that they adapt your work situation to the disease. So they had a possibility to adapt until they got worse. My dad was very open with his friends. I talked about it a bit inside the family. And when he met my mom, he was very open with her, saying that my dad died of this disease and it's genetic and I have it. And when they got to the point where they were talking about marriage and children, my dad said that I have this genetic disease and the kid can have it as well. And my mom was very aware and still got married and had me, because in that time we didn't have like those genetic things you could do when getting a kid to make sure they're healthy. Like, that didn't exist. There were only like the ones where you had to test the fetus itself, and then if it's not healthy, then abortion. And my mom, well, she wouldn't dare to do that, because if you're in that point where you want the kid, of course, that would hurt a lot if the kid was tested positive. So they took the risk. And when it comes to me, when I was a child, that was like, they told me that, oh, we have this disease in our family, your uncle had it, and then your dad had it, but they didn't explain any further. And it was because the neurologist told my family that you shouldn't tell the children. Like, that would just make them confused or scared, or it wasn't necessary, when it's actually the opposite. So I grew up with a bad mentality of thinking everything that was going on with my dad was my fault. So that was something that was really wrong, that they should have talked with me just like they talked with everyone else openly, I believe.
Megha?
So from my knowledge, my brother and I were never informed by our parents. I think the first time I found a letter on my dad's laptop. I was 17. And to date, my brother and I have discussed Huntington's twice. He's 3 years older than me. We're very close. And the only times we've spoken about Huntington's openly is when I put him in front of the camera, because I've needed to shoot with him. So within my family, for some reason, it's been a very, very private thing. My mom and I speak about it very openly now, but I remember asking her a long time back when she started talking to people, because she told me that she didn't want to tell me and my brother because she wanted to protect us. And she said that the first time she ever told people, apart from I think two or three of her friends, that my dad had Huntington's was after he had passed away. And for me, it's just a little unbelievable, because like, how do you hide something like this? And even at home, I think once I was 18 or 19, my dad would come up to me and be like, you know, I'm unwell. But the words Huntington's were literally never discussed. And even now, I think within my extended family, it's not a conversation you have. It's for the longest time, my cousins, my aunt's children thought that she just had brain atrophy. They refused to believe that it's Huntington's. I think because of the misdiagnosis and many other things, and just not that lack of knowledge, it was easier to not have to explain to people what it is and just kind of not talk about it. So yeah, absolutely.
What do you think are some of the limitations to access to support and care are in your countries that you've lived in? It could be anywhere from financial, it could be just the lack of having services offered, it could be a lot of different reasons. What are some of those limitations you've experienced or you know others have?
Well, I believe all of it, like transportation or when the parent gets sick, that the economy just goes so bad for the entire family, because usually the person, like just the normal income is very crucial to make sure that everyone has at least the basics. And with in my case, well, since my dad got sick, he denied wanting to go to work. And just when he got diagnosed, even though they offered him a chance to adapt or do other things, and that was bad because my mom is an immigrant, so that doesn't make it easier to get a good salary. My dad had the best salary between those two, so losing that income was really hard, and the money he gets from the state for being sick was not a lot. It barely covered anything, to be honest. And so my mom basically had to work like crazy when they were married. And sadly, that caused me to not having none of my parents available because of it. And I believe that's the case for most of us that have one parent who's sick, and then the other one has to take care of the parent or go work, and then none of them are available, or you have to be caregiver for the parent. So it all is just a bad circle going around. And especially in Colombia, it's even worse, because since the income is so low, sometimes children have to find a way to earn money as well, and make sure that they have at least food in the house and stuff. Because of how bad the situation can get here, especially in the more poor areas. So it was really hard, I believe. And when it comes to getting access to things, I remember when I was like 8 or 10 years old, they, instead of like accepting my mom as someone who would take care of my dad, they ignored her just because of the language barrier. So they looked at me, who knew the language perfectly and was integrated and stuff. And I had to be at meetings about my dad at 10 years old. And they thought that would be okay. And I had to fight my dad's right to get transportation, therapies and stuff at just around 10 years old until I was like 23. So really crazy how a country can go like that, and as well discriminate my mother, making her like some kind of person that doesn't know anything when she in fact is a very intelligent woman. It's just that the language is hard, obviously, when you come to another country at 30 years old. So those are like the main things that happen to us. I want to hear what the other has to say.
Yeah, similar things to Colombia, I guess. There's huge financial pressures when a parent or a family member is diagnosed. So in Pakistan, it's mostly a patriarchal society. So if the father gets HD, basically that source of income is gone, and the children have to either go to work and become caregivers at the same time. So it's a very difficult situation to be in. And in terms of support, there is basically none. No medical support. If you're like pretty privileged, well off, you can get private healthcare, which helps a lot. But for people living in rural or disadvantaged communities, pretty much you're on your own. So children have to usually become caregivers and work at the same time. It's a pretty unfortunate situation. So yeah, huge financial pressures, huge family pressure as well, And then you're ostracized from the community as well, so you don't get that community help. So it's like a vicious circle to be in.
Yeah, I think very similar to what Mustafa said, because in India, again, because of the lack of infrastructure and because it's still primarily an agrarian society, if you're in a rural community, having access to a hospital that even understands Huntington's or has healthcare for that or mental health diseases, you're probably traveling 6-10 hours just to get to that hospital. It's extremely expensive. The financial strain is a lot. I remember meeting a family that was lucky to live in a state where the Huntington's Disease Society of India is formed. So they had been asked by the doctors to keep coming regularly. And when I had met them last, they had told me that they had stopped going because they just didn't have the finances. Because even in India, it's not like the government is funding you. It's not like the government is even funding the hospital more often than not. So the financial strain is a lot. And I think even when it, not just that, I feel like it also comes down to the lack of education, because most of the families that I've interacted with have gone to 6-10 doctors in different states who've all diagnosed them in different ways, have never possibly heard about Huntington's. Till you come to one, there's one hospital in India that actually works around Huntington's, which is yeah. So if you have it, the access to medical facilities is close to none, but also having to have that conversation with the doctor that doesn't have the education and understands the disease gets very, very tricky over here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
I think that access to information is key as well, especially for young people, because traditionally, the conversation around Huntington's disease, as you all have shared, was really between the person who was diagnosed and their partner, whoever was directly supporting them. And you all as young people had this big question mark of what's happening in our family. What does this mean? Maybe the fear of even bringing it up, or, you know, how this really impacted me. And you all mentioned a little bit about reaching out to resources outside of your country to be able to get that support. I'm curious, what do you think some of the challenges are where you've lived to having some structured support for young people specifically to have an open forum to talk about these different challenges and needs?
Well, here in Colombia, it's very complicated because mm-hmm. I just joined the Colombian Huntington Association, and I actually, together with another HD ambassador, actually, we had to plan together how to create one because there wasn't one. It was always focused first on the patient and then on the family, but not on the youth, like separately, and how to help them and how to make sure they have everything when it comes to information or a companion or whatever is needed. And that's today, and that's very sad. In Sweden, I remember that I was actually one of the first generations when I was around 10 years old that got into the youth organization for association in Sweden. So that was 17 years ago, and that's also nothing, if I have to be honest. I believe that like the focus should be on everyone, like mm-hmm. both the family, the patient, but also the kids, whether like age doesn't matter, to be honest. I think it's important that everyone get the resources that they need. So it's sad that we haven't like evolved so much too. So I believe that's why we're here today, especially us three that are fighting to make sure that everyone, especially in the youth community, get a special association and the information that is needed.
I mean, yeah. We can have, sorry, Mustafa, you can go ahead.
Yeah, so I was just going to hop on and say similar experiences. No, there was no, or yeah, there was no association, like a national association for Pakistan till about a month ago, which you basically, I had to create with other doctors, sort of get the ball rolling. But yeah, no access to testing when I was younger. So like, even if I wanted to get tested at, let's say 2021, I wouldn't be able to go to a doctor because the test would be expensive. We don't have local testing facilities. they would have to send my blood sample abroad to get a confirmation of diagnosis, and that's what the current state of affairs is. No emotional support, therapy, and psychological counseling is not really a thing in most of Pakistan. Now it's coming in slowly in major cities, but in rural areas, again, that's not going to be an issue, a thing at all. So a severe lack of support just overall around Huntington's disease.
So we have HDSI in India, which started in 2019, so it's also relatively new. And the group has a lot of people, but apart from me and one more person, I haven't met somebody in my age group in their 20s or early 30s. And I think a result of that is one that, because you're not telling your kids at all about it, they aren't aware that they need the support. And the idea of a support group seems like a very distant dream in India right now, because HDSI is completely volunteer-based. So the people who are doing it are exhausted because they're all caregivers. A lot of them are patients, and they're doing a lot of work, and having to even think about the idea that a support group is needed is a next level thing. And I think even outside of HDSI, the idea of support groups is just not something India has. Like, misery is a very private thing. You don't talk about it. It's within your homes and your families. Maybe you'll be lucky to talk to a few friends, but you're supposed to deal with it yourself. So that access isn't there here either. Yeah.
I'm so glad you brought that up about the associations, because it is hard, because the lack of funding and support to build those associations relies almost solely on the families and caregivers and volunteers who want to see that happen, whether it's young people or, I mean, you all are super active in trying to get those things off the ground and continue to support. And the burden is way too much on the community to have those done. And I think that's where these awareness pieces come into play. And it is so country specific, because sometimes there are countries who allow for support through their national health services or other grants that might be offered. That's a privilege to have those things. And when you're looking at the priority, even within HD, a lot of times it does fall on the person who is going through the symptoms right now, who needs the active treatment, which makes sense. But as we know with HD, there are so many layers within the community and the family and the mental health anguish that can happen, and the questions and things like that, that lobbying for those young people to get that support is really important. And it continues to need to be important to the research community, because we need to empower young people to be their best advocate, so then they can also make those important decisions on how can they contribute to research, how can they contribute to this larger cause too, and be active partners. So it is really important to include all of that, and to also include the fact that those support services need to be more diversified globally in many communities, because people don't know of people in those communities with HD doesn't mean that they don't exist.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, people don't know because they don't talk about it, right? So if you don't talk about it, you won't know if your neighbor has HD, or like if someone in the community is suffering, but since they won't talk about it, you won't ever know.
And the harsh reality is that you need large numbers to be able to prove that. So if you have these very layered stigmas that happen, and there's nobody telling people that there are safe ways to get involved, and we need you all to speak up, and here's how you can do it, and we'll support you along the way, you're not going to ever hear from it. So it gets really frustrating, because if you don't, one, see people who look like you encouraging you to participate. If you don't have people who are there on the ground who are investing in your own well-being, and if there's no access to anything to do with that information from the get-go, why would you get involved? Why would you take that step forward? It's a tremendous step to ask people.
Yeah, like, I mean, in I think when they were starting HDSI, something like 2 or 3 years back, they still had 40 or 50 families. Now it's about 200 families, because anybody who comes to NIMHANS, they're usually urged to join the community because NIMHANS kind of started HDSI. But if you don't know about Huntington's, because I have a friend whose uncle's brother tested for it. And only because she knows me and am I being able to talk to them, because when they found out about a year back, they had no idea about it. They didn't know who to talk to. They didn't even know what it was. So not understanding where you're supposed to go, what kind of care you're supposed to be given, and then even knowing that there is a community is a later thing. So yeah, it's, I feel like in India especially, it's like there are a lot of people who have it. It's not like it's a small thing, and there's just no way of actually amplifying that voice and saying that there are people who can like help you out.
I think that's the, sorry, go ahead, Anne.
Thank you. No, it's I agree with Megha, because we have the same issue here. Since ever, like, Colombia has a lot of inhabitants, and we know, like, for a fact that our neighbor Venezuela in Merida, that was where you discovered HD in the first place. So I do believe that if that's what's going on there, there should be a lot of cases like that here, because it is. It is a fact that is going on. And when I look at the association, we have like, what, 40 members? And I get so surprised, because the country is huge. So that really tells a lot about the stigmas and not talking about it, how bad that can be. Because if we don't have an association, then there's harder times to fix and get everything that people need and stuff. And I remember, like, a couple of years ago, I had my mom's cousin teach me art. And out of nowhere, she was asking, like, how my dad was doing, because according to her, my mom had told her that he had a brain tumor. And then I was like, no, my dad had HD. And then she looked at me like, your dad had HD? And I'm like, yeah, you know what that is? And she's like, yeah, my husband had it. He passed away with the same disease, and my two sons were at risk, and they tested negative. And I looked at her and then realized that my mom didn't know, and she didn't know, and they both were married to a man who had HD. So, I mean, if they both knew, they could have talked about it, and especially in their own language, and that would have helped probably a lot. So I do seem that that's an issue with the stigmas here, that the hush-hush community can actually do more harm than good.
Well, I think that because you don't always hear from other people in the community who have HD, I think also there's that that fear for individuals that no one will understand it, when really that exact example, if either your aunt or your mother mentioned Huntington's disease at all, you would see that there was this connection that was not in line with genetics between the two, but that there happened to be these two families impacted by HD who were married and related through that way, which is really powerful. And it's kind of like, once you start talking about it, you hear more about it. And it's that first step to really start sharing about it. And I think that's what, you know, all of these things are the reason why HDYO exists, is to be able to provide that platform for people to reach out, especially if they don't have the comfort level of reaching out in their own country or family, or just don't even know where to start. And also the power of the ambassador program. Right now we have 95 ambassadors from across the globe who are there to support each other. And it's a way that's done that can be done anonymously as well. And you all are very open with sharing your story, but for every one ambassador who's open about sharing their story, you'll probably have two or three who don't. So, but they are very active in their own way and supporting one another. So, you know, creating that safe place is what we want to do, and to help support with all of you all. So please reach out if you have any questions about resources or where to start, or interested in learning more about the ambassador program. Thinking about some really specifics regarding stigmas, and some of these we've shared a little bit about this, but I want to break it down a little bit more. So what do you feel like are some of the hesitancies when seeking out medical support from a doctor or a mental health support person? What are some of those barriers around that?
I've faced just a general lack of knowledge. I've been to, I would say, 10 therapists in the last 15 years. I haven't come across a single one of them who actually knows what Huntington's is, One tried telling me that, oh, it's probably, you can definitely cure it. Another told me that if my dad had a certain CAG repeat, then mine has to be lower. It was just random information, which I don't even know where they were getting it from at that point. But I feel like personally for me, I'm hesitant to talk about it because it's tiring to have to explain it, especially to somebody in the medical field. I feel like they should know about it. And it's okay if you don't, but I feel like not having heard about it at all it's really sad because I'm only talking about therapists, but I feel like in India, even if you go to a neurologist more often than not, and I know this happens in many other countries where you're kind of misdiagnosed first with Parkinson's or with something else before it comes down to Huntington's. But I think it's already such a daunting illness because of the myriad of things that it comes with, and it's so difficult to go to somebody and talk about it and open up about it and tell a doctor what is going on. And when they turn around and have assumptions about it, it just closes you off. So I feel like that's something, I mean, it's baffling what lack of medical knowledge there is in India when it comes to something like this.
Yeah, well, in our case, it's very similar. Excuse me. Okay, in our case, it's similar to Megha's. We had, in my case, since I needed a therapist and since I was a kid because of everything going on at the house, none of the psychologists that I have since I was a kid until I was an adult knew. And I think they did more harm than good when it came to that, because there were a few who, I had two psychologists I know with the diploma I had. One I had when I was in a bad place in high school, and the other one was when my dad passed away and I searched for support. And both of them told me, one of them told me she knew about the disease, and she told me, like, straight with the face, with a straight face, saying that, well, you shouldn't be worried and have anxiety about your father. He has Huntington's disease. He will pass away soon, so all of those issues will disappear. So I don't understand why you're anxious about this. And it was really awful when they do that, because I had to quit, and then I have to search for a new one. And like Megha said, it ends up with you, instead of having where you're supposed to vent, you have to use your time to explain what the disease is and what is doing to you as well to the psychologist. So you're wasting your time just explaining and making sure they understand. And I believe that when it comes to psychologists or neurologists in general, that if they have a patient and the patient tells that they have a history where a family member has HD, they should prepare themselves by informing, reading and making sure the sources are adequate to today's date, and that it's not something that is random facts, like Megha said. Because I do believe, like, sure, you can't learn about every diagnosis, and Huntington's is a rare disease, we have to admit that. But at the same time, I do believe it's their job to make sure that when a patient like that comes asking for help, that they should make sure, like, okay, I know about this disease, or I will try to know. And if there's something I don't understand, I will ask them directly. I know that now with my recent psychologist, just 2 days ago, she was asking me about genetic testing. So I had to explain to her the entire process and explain that it's not just taking a test and then that's it and you're done. I had to explain that it's a long process, and it is torture, basically, because you don't know what's going on and if you're going to get a yes or a no. And sometimes both can cause anxiety, of course, and harm. And this, so it's important to have I told her that that's why it's important that you're still here with me when I'm doing the test and you're aware of this. So when the day comes, I have a good support system. So yeah, those things I do believe are really important.
Yeah, similar experiences. I think often we have to educate the people who are supposed to educate you, and you end up telling them, okay, this is a disease. This is the major symptoms, you know, this is how you're supposed to counsel someone, and you're there to get counseling yourself. So you end up educating them on how to, you know, handle you, which is quite unfortunate. I think there's been a few horror stories in Pakistan. There's a lot of stigma around approaching medical care, especially when it comes to Huntington's disease. It has not been handled well in the past for people who had access to medical care. So like, if you imagine now someone who's rural, you know, first of all, they don't have access to care in the first place. It's very, very difficult to approach or find medical care. People are, you know, just get on with it and do the best they can.
I think it's important to note that just in general, professionals need to be aware that this could be the first time that that individual is actually asking for help. So if they have a bad experience and you're making an assumption that they do have support services or they know what to expect and you're not taking the time to approach them with empathy, it can easily deter them forever reaching back out for a lot of different aspects of it. The simple thing from the person answering the phones to schedule an appointment at the very get-go, empathy needs to be used across the board.
I wanted to add something about, actually this is something related to what Anne Elizabeth had said about like genetic testing. The other thing that I've noticed in India that's, there's no standard around genetic testing. I think I know maybe 4 or 5 places that do it. Maybe there are more now, but I remember when I had gone in for my testing, my understanding of the whole genetic testing and the process was how it's done in the US or in Europe or in the UK. And when I had gone to my geneticist for the first time, she had a chat with me for about 30 minutes, took me to the lab. I got my blood test, and then I got my results 3 days later. And the reason it was 3 days later is because there was Christmas in the middle. I would have gotten it the next day. I think I was, maybe because I don't know how I really took it, to be fair, but I feel like there was no standard to understanding how it was done. I genuinely assumed that I would go through about 6-7 sessions. I'd move to the city where I wanted to do it because I thought I'd be doing this for about 8-9 months before getting the test. I thought I would wait about 6 weeks before I get the results. I got the results on the phone before I went to her. And I was like, and I had really studied as much as I could about Huntington's, and my mom and I were talking about it at that point. But for somebody who decides to go through genetic testing and how it completely changes your perspective towards life, the fact that there are some of the best hospitals in India do it the way that I had it is bizarre. Yeah, I guess.
Yeah. We do.
Go ahead.
Okay, so yeah, we here in Colombia, it's the same. It's really awful, the process, because not only are you just getting tested and that's it, and usually people get the result by phone today. It's also bad because here, for instance, I can't tell doctors that there's Huntington's disease in my family to general doctors or nurses, because if that's in my, what's it called, in my journal, basically, that means that I don't get access to insurance. That means I don't get access to any jobs, basically. And so you have to keep a hush about it, which is really bad, because people are supposed to like, hey, I have this in my family. Okay, we'll make sure we have it in your journal, but that it's nothing that's going to affect you in the future. But it is here, especially. So it's really frustrating that it is that way. And that also makes it harder, because that's just making sure that the stigma is still there, even with the hospitals and seeking help in general. which I think is really bad. And just like Megha said, the experience with genetic testing is not the same like in Sweden. I do believe it's a privilege in Sweden right now, because you can go there and you can decide whenever you want on how long it should be the process. Your psychologist tells you if you are ready mentally or not. And when the day comes where you get tested, you have the right to say no if you don't want to know right now and you think it's a bad moment. And the process is about 1 month of waiting, but you still get psychological help before, during, and after the test results, which I think is amazing because that's how it's supposed to be. But that's a privilege in my city, because not in all of Sweden, they do have that privilege. Some still do to this day have the same, where they do a blood test result and then they get a call and that's it. You don't get any more help. So it's really scary how it, even in one country, it can be so different in every city. And when it comes to a different continent as well, in our case, is that they just don't care, like no empathy, like you'd say, you know, about the whole situation, that one is a human with emotions, and especially in this case, a lot of anxiety. So I do believe that they should do more. We're still fighting our associations with all of the neurologists and places that they should improve with that, but it's very hard. It requires like congresses and conferences where all of them are united just to inform them. It takes time, especially our case in Sweden. Like, we're still ongoing with educating nurses and doctors about how to do it and everything with the, when it comes to at risk or not, or the family itself. So, yeah.
It's really absolutely similar experiences to Anna's, but I find that you have to build the medical capacity as an association yourself, whereas that should be existing in the first place whenever a patient goes. Unfortunately, that's not the case, and you sort of have to get everyone on board, genetic counselors. Similar to Megha, the testing process in Pakistan used to be that way, where you could just go and get a blood test or send the blood to another country to get your CD repeat size. But now, with the association, we're now pushing medical professionals to, hey, you need to actually properly counsel these patients. You know, you can't just test on the same day, but it's a long drawn out process. Some doctors aren't really cooperative, some are. So hopefully over time, this will change.
Yeah, it does take that partnership. And unfortunately, again, the burden on the families to help lead this cause. I want to talk, one thing we haven't talked about yet is research, which I know is such a hot topic, especially in communities where there's little to no opportunities to participate. So, you know, not only are there the stigmas that we've talked about as far as awareness, education, access to different resources, a big access is to research. What do you think about that? I don't even know how to start that because it's very complicated.
I will jump in because I am in research, at least not in clinical trials, but more like basic research. But in terms of like clinical trials, one, people don't know what a clinical trial is. Like a lot of patients and families just think that, oh, maybe there's a medicine. If there's not, you know, that's it. You know, there's no current ongoing research, and if they read about it, they don't think about it as something they can access anyway, because it would require them leaving the country, and that's just simply not possible. I think there needs to be a push to bring equitable access to clinical trials all over the world. The current HD clinical trials are mostly centered in Europe, sometimes in Australia, but not always. Europe, US, Canada, and Australia mainly. I think 2 or 3 days ago, the International Huntington's Association went to the Middle East, which I think is fantastic. So there potentially might be a site in the future, somewhere down the line, I hope, a clinical trial site in the Middle East. It's not in India or Pakistan, but you know, it's more accessible than someone going to Europe, because you can travel to the Middle East easier than you would travel to Europe. But again, the costs required for that travel, in accommodations, it's unfortunately, in this day and age, it's currently out of reach for, I would say, 99% of Pakistanis to access a clinical trial and to access research.
I was going to say, even if they're allowed to travel to participate, and even if the language could be understood in order to consent and to be able to participate, which adds into a lot of the different complexities.
Yeah. And even if they're allowed to prosper, they may not be eligible anywhere, right? So,
For me, it's kind of funny because in Sweden, we haven't a lot of research, especially when it comes to enroll HD. Because you're not allowed by law to send your blood outside the country. So we have been fighting a lot when it comes to being able to do research, because we do have a lot of families that are interested and that have the privilege of traveling to other cities or such to do it. So that has been a long fight that we still that is still ongoing to this day. And that's in Europe, like that's in Sweden. However, in Colombia, we actually do have research, like they are inside Enroll HD. I myself just this year got in, and it was amazing because they were doing everything so well and making sure you're okay. And when you're telling your family story, they're very empathetic and everyone understands. So you really get informed in an easy way that is like making sure that everyone understands. In the case of when you come from the rural areas, it can be harder when you have lower education, for example, to understand research and their information. But the good part is that when it comes to this place, say here in Medellin or in Bogota, you actually do get easy information about everything and participation and what it means and implies and how it can help you. And you also get money for traveling. So I think that's really great, because this country, I know we have a lot of people that doesn't have the money or the time to do so. So if someone pays at least the money that disappears by traveling and taking a break from work, for instance, then that's super good of them. I do believe that. And with the association, we're trying to make more people get involved in research in general. And for instance, in my case, I'm making easy translations when it comes to research that is coming out today, and making sure that everyone in our community are understanding on what's going on in this very moment. Because I do believe that easy access to information is very crucial for everyone, and that it should be something that everyone should understand regarding where they come from, or if they're upper lower class, or their education in general. So I think that's very impressive when it comes to Colombia, and hope we can get more people get involved in our association just so they can get the right information like this.
In India, I think we don't have clinical trials or any such research. And I've been really lucky that, I mean, in the UK, at least I have access to it. But over here, even if it was there, I think similar to what Mustafa was saying, if you're going in for a clinical trial, the assumption is that you're going to come out cured or better. That understanding of what a clinical trial is not really there. And there's also that financial burden. So if somebody is aware of what a clinical trial is and does want to be able to participate in it, it still is there is that financial strain, because you're not really going to get paid for your travel or the time that you're spending over there. So it's very difficult to have clinical trials in India. I know they were trying to do it a couple of years back and it still hasn't happened. And as far as I know, there isn't any research as such being conducted over here.
I think Yeah, I just want to quickly point out Enroll. Enroll is fantastic, but Enroll doesn't have a current site, I think, in Asia at all. So I think the push from patient organizations, and this is what I'm working towards in Pakistan, is potentially setting up what's it called in the HDA Center of Excellences, a similar setup in Pakistan, so that it makes it more attractive for these research programs to come here and then set up. So I think that's the path forward. How long that takes is, yeah, I don't really have an answer for that, but maybe in the next 5 to 10 years, we can see some sort of research being set up in India and Pakistan. Because if Enroll comes, you know, you get that patient data, then you can start bringing in actual pharma companies to conduct clinical trials.
I'm going to just tee this up. There's going to be some news about how people can also participate in some additional online support and things like that in order to say where they live, which is going to be really important when we're looking at where clinical trials can be in future years. In addition, though, research can take place in a lot of different forms. And there's observational studies like Enroll HD, which are absolutely fundamental to the infrastructure and the interest in different clinical partners focusing on HD, because there is this vast knowledge of information out there, including where people are and working and sharing those different findings through that study. So if you do have the opportunity to participate in Enroll HD, please take a look at it. In addition, there are things like registries and surveys, which many of these can be done from the comfort of your own home. And at HDYO, we have not only our registry, which is global for families impacted by juvenile HD, called Join HD, but we also have a survey series that right now is translated, and we're getting approved for about 6 additional languages. So that would bring us to about 11 or 12 languages that anybody 18 and older can participate in sharing their experiences and opinions. And I'm going to be looking at you, Mustafa and Megha, to help us translate to get the communities in Pakistan and India access to be able to share their insights. So we have a couple of different surveys out there. One is, how are you finding resources and support? So what are those areas that you find are reputable to seek out that information? The reason that we're doing that is that we know as a community that the traditional mechanisms of communication aren't working for future generations. And as clinical trials continue to progress, we are going to be targeting the same patient community that has been positioned to participate in previous clinical trials. And being a rare disease, we need to diversify what that looks like. So we need to have new ways of communication to be able to educate people about clinical trials and research, social services, but then also understand how the community wants to be told about that information. So that's survey one. We've had over 600 respondents globally with that first survey, and it's still open. So that's really important to do. The second one that we released earlier this year is about different stigmas and educational barriers about research in general. And there have been a lot of studies very similar to what you've talked about the burden of participating when it comes to financial needs, time off of work, childcare support services, those kinds of things. This is looking at the emotional barriers to participating in research, as well as the educational barriers. So there's a lot of assumptions that can be made when you're hearing different presentations about the community's awareness of these different research terms, the fear associated with those different research terms. And so we want to analyze that globally. So again, we can help take away some of those stigmas, that burden, really invest in the education for the global community to be better informed and doing that information, better empowered to make decisions for themselves as things come down the line. So again, that's going to be translated in more than 10 languages here really soon. There's already 5 or 6 that are available now for that. So take a look at those. The next one we're doing is we're going to be following the life of young people when it comes to their own personal milestones, as well as how HD has impacted those. So for example, a lot of times people try to treat young people with a one-size-fits-all mentality when we know that that's not the case, because someone finding out about Huntington's disease at age 5 has a very different experience than 25, than 35. And the reasons are is because life is happening outside of that. You're already making future plans. You're already determining who you are as an individual, and you can have these big HD impacts that can change all of that thinking, which is extremely disrupting. So we want to be able to understand what people's experiences are at key HD milestones and what's going on in their life, which influences that, in order to, again, provide those better support services. So those are ways that those communities who don't have access to participate in physical trials can also participate in research by sharing their lived experiences, because that in tune will help us, because we need those large numbers to show that this is what the community needs, be able to better advocate for you all. So please consider taking a look at that and heading over to hdyo.org and looking at the research section for that. And thank you for all who have participated, because it's we are already presenting that information at different scientific conferences. And so it's really exciting to see people starting to look at those responses. So this has been a fantastic conversation to share across many different cultures, see what some of the commonalities are, some of the access issues that can be translated from different countries and cultures, but also very specific needs. What would you all, if you had the opportunity to say to the professional community, which can include advocacy, research partners, support workers, mental health professionals, what would you say to them in order to do better?
Give money to patient organizations to bring in support services. I think there's a severe lack of funding for all these organizations. They do a lot of the heavy lifting when it comes to taking care of families and their patients and Huntington's disease patients, to provide that support. Because what people don't realize is that after testing, there's no plan for what comes after, right? After you're out of that, you know, medical world, you're just on your own, expected to deal with it and move on. And all these patient organizations then come in to step up. So I think they are absolutely essential and should be funded better.
Yeah, as a representative of HDCAP, it's what we stand for, and that is to please, get involved with us, patients, associations, everything, because by understanding our side of the story, it makes it easier for them later on to progress in their work, or if there's something they're unsure about, they can just ask us, which has happened, because I do believe that it's better that we work together than we work separately. Because with communication, like, communication is key. So by being together in this, it will make it easier to understand what HD is all about and what research is all about, and help us as well. So yeah, I do believe that. That's what is them.
I think I'd say just have empathy when interacting with the HD community. It educates you a lot more than you will realize when you keep your mind open to talking to somebody from the community. And it also lets somebody feel seen and be open about what they're going through. And I think that goes very far in when it comes to research, but also support groups and how the community works with each other. So yeah, empathizing and talking nicely is will go very far.
Amazing advice. And I'd also add in taking for the community perspective, advocating for our HD community members, especially young people, to make that brave step forward to reach out to associations and organizations. We know it takes a lot, but it's really amazing. And we will be at HDYO, we'll be hosting our second in-person international congress in Prague, Czech Republic, in March 14th to the 16th in 2025, and scholarships are available. So for those of you who haven't had the opportunity to meet others in the community or want to learn more, please, I encourage you to go to hdyocongress.org and apply for a scholarship, because that's a really great way to meet others. And it's overwhelming in many different senses of the word to be in a room of people who just understand HD and not having to wear that badge and that burden of having to educate others about it. And even scientists, partners, you need to attend, because it's a great way for you to hear from the young person's perspective and to really hear firsthand what some young people go through and how we can better support them. Closing remarks. What else do you want to say? How would you give advice for anybody else? What do you want to say as we wrap up?
Talk to people. Don't like bottle it in. Reach out to your associations, reach out to HDYO. That's what I did. I think talking helps. You will find the support you need, because people, in my opinion, generally want to help you. So we will make that happen as an association or from the HDYO perspective. So yeah, just reach out, talk to people. And the basic message is, no one's alone in this. You have people who have experienced HT. You just need to reach out and talk about it, and we can help you.
Pretty much the same. I think reach out to people, talk. If you think it's harder to talk to somebody who's a family or a friend, reach out to HDYO, because I think most of us did. And it's taken us much further because it's a global community. There will be somebody who understands your perspective. There'll be somebody who will be willing to listen to you and give you the right resources. There are lots of people in the HDYO community, so it's not like you're going to be, there will be no lack of resources. And if it just means coming to terms with whatever you're going through in your life and just needing somebody to pick up the phone with and talk to every weekend, there are people in the community who will do it for you. So yeah, please reach out.
Yeah, and don't be scared. Even I know for a fact, when you're alone and don't know how the people are going to be and such, taking the first step is the one that helps the most for your own good. And you're doing self-care by seeking help. And even if you maybe come from a place where maybe they don't have enough support when it comes to HD or an association, HDO is available. We have amazing ambassadors that you can talk with. And there's also people in general that can help to make sure that you get the resources, even if you don't have it in your home right this instance. So I do believe that it's important to know that, and that it's not this big scary world that you will enter, but more of a big resource for your own self-care. So I do believe that together with this group, that by seeking help, you're helping yourself.
I love all of that. Thank you all so much for your time today. You all just continue to inspire me, and I love seeing your faces together and getting a chance to see you all in person sometimes. And it's really a tight-knit community. And just to echo, I know it can feel scary to reach out, but once you do reach out, you'll be embraced by a lot of people who care, I think, which is really important. Well, thank you all so much for taking the time to watch this. And please know that HDYO is only an email away. Our website is hdyo.org, and we're here to help in any way that we can. And thank you so much again to our panelists for sharing their perspectives today, and stay tuned for more Breaking Down Barriers.